May the joy of the Lord be with you in lockdown and beyond lockdown. I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land where we broadcast from today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. I'd like to pay our respects to the elders, past, present, and emerging, and pledge our ongoing commitment to reconciliation and justice for First Peoples and others in this land. Our call to worship and opening prayer. Make us wise, Lord. Not clever, not top of the class, not a know-it-all or arrogant, not a smart aleck or as clever as Alexa. Just make us wise, Lord, that we might see you more clearly, know you more deeply, and love you more dearly. May your Spirit be upon us as we engage in worship this day. All wise, all loving God, we are grateful for all that we have learned in our journey through life this far, but we know that we have a long way to go to become truly wise. Show us who to seek out and who to avoid if we are to grow in your ways. Wake us up to what we already know and teach us what we need to learn so we may grow wiser and kinder as we grow in years. Amen. Shine, Jesus, shine. Let's sing.
Spirit, please set our hearts.
Well, welcome everyone in our community, those sharing in the live streaming this morning, and also welcome to those who watch the video later on. We are blessed to have the equipment and the expertise to stay connected with each other in this way. Thanks again to Jeff and Richard for all that they contribute in this regard. And thanks to all of you for your continued care for each other and encouragement. And thank you also for the sharing of wisdom that helps us to survive as a community and as individuals with hope and joy and love. There's going to be a change of worship leadership over the next three Sundays. I'll be on the job here till Friday. But having a quarterly Sunday off, followed by 2 weeks of annual leave. The plan was to go north for sunshine and adventure. Plan B will be a bit closer to home. You'll be able to enjoy different faces and different styles while I'm away. And a big thanks to James and Mandy and Peter and Janet and Duncan and others will be stepping up with their gifts and their wisdom. Our prayer of confession today has a reasonably long response that I invite you to join in. Let us pray. Most loving God, you through long ages have shaped humanity out of soil, sunshine, air and water and breathed your own spirit into us. Yet we have often lived as if we were the self-made race. We pretend that our half-truths are wisdom and that our occasional kindnesses are love. When things go well, we praise ourselves. When things go wrong, we accuse others or blame you. Have mercy on the rank silliness that distorts our behaviour, the ease with which we get seduced by trivial goals, the clumsiness and insecurity that mark our relationships, the burdens and hurts we impose on one another, the sneaky way we dilute the gospel to suit our prejudices, and the apathy that gets in the way between us and your saving grace. Please pity our weakness and forgive our sins. With your grace, taking away our shame and healing the diseases of our spirit, let us begin again with no agenda except that of loving to live as your redeemed children through Christ our Saviour. Amen. The Lord is gracious and merciful and comes to us to redeem us. Christ Jesus offers himself to us, forgiving our sins and promising to raise us to life on the last day. Sisters and brothers, your sins are forgiven. Be at peace. Thanks be to God. Amen. Majesty, worship his majesty. Let's sing.
Thank you.
We're going to have a look at a short movie clip now, and I wonder how many people will recognize the movie and know the story. Hello, Charlie and Big Ted. I wonder if you're going to recognize this movie as well. Let's have a look, see if you know it, Charlie.
Does it feel good to be out of there? I'm telling you, nice to be back, ladies and gentlemen. Hi, where are you from? What's your name?
Aladdin.
Aladdin! Hello, Aladdin. Nice to have you on the show. Can we call you Al? Or maybe just Din? Or how about Lobby? Sounds like, here, boy. Come on, Lobby.
I must have hit my head harder than I thought.
You smoke? Mind if I do? Oh, sorry, Cheetah. I hope I didn't singe the fur. Yo, Rugman. Haven't seen you in a few millennia. Give me some tassel. Yeah, yo, yo. Say, you're a lot smaller than my last master. Either that or I'm getting bigger. Look at me from the side. Do I look different to you?
Wait a minute. I'm your master?
That's right. He can be taught. What would you wish of me?
Be ever impressive.
The form contained. But never duplicated. Genie of the lamp. Right here, direct from the lamp. Right here for your very much wish fulfillment. Thank you.
Whoa. Wish fulfillment?
3 wishes to be exact. An ixnay on the wishing for more wishes. That's it. 3. One of those three. No substitutions, exchanges, or re.
One. I'm seeing a nod and a smile, Charlie. You know the story. Have you watched that movie? Yeah, and Big Ted has with you as well. Very good. We're having a... I showed that video today because in some ways it's a bit similar to the Bible story we're going to look at today, where someone gets the chance to effectively make a wish, say what they would like. I wonder, Charlie, if you remember how the story keeps on going for Aladdin, what 3 wishes he takes. Do you know what they are? You know, the first one, he wants to become a prince because he wants the princess to be interested in him. He wants to become, which is funny because the story we're having today, Solomon already is a prince. He already is a king even, so actually he doesn't need to ask for that. What about the second one? How does Aladdin use his second wish? Do you remember? I think it's, you do. He has to wish for something for himself because, is he drowning? Yeah, and he needs to be saved, and so he gets the genie to save him. Then the third wish, that's a bit of an interesting one because at first Aladdin says he's going to use that to set the genie free. And then he changes his mind and he's sort of got more selfish things he's going to do with his wish. But in the end, he decides to use that third wish to set the genie free. It's a good story. You like it? What would you say? Thumbs up. It's an okay story. It's a thumbs up. It's one of your faves. Very good. Well, in the Bible story today, as I was saying, there's a few things that are similar and a few things that are different. And so Solomon, who's just become king, he has a dream where God asks him what he wants. And a bit like Aladdin gets to, Solomon doesn't just ask for something for himself. He asks for something that's going to make a difference to all the people of God. So let's have a listen to that story and our other Bible reading. Thanks, Pete.
Okay, our reading this morning is from 1 Kings, chapter 2. Verses 10 to 12, and then chapter 3, verses 3 to 14, and I'm reading from the Good News Translation. David died and was buried in David's city. He had been king of Israel for 40 years, ruling 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. Solomon succeeded his father, David, as king, and his royal power was firmly established. Solomon loved the Lord and followed the instructions of his father David, but he also slaughtered animals and offered them as sacrifices on various altars. On one occasion, he went to Gibeon to offer sacrifices because that was where the most famous altar was. He had offered hundreds of burnt offerings there in the past. And that night, the Lord appeared to him in a dream and asked him, "What would you like me to give you?" Solomon answered, "You always showed great love for my father David, your servant, and he was good, loyal, and honest in his relationship with you. And you have continued to show him your grace and constant love by giving him a son who today rules in his place. O Lord God, you have let me succeed my father as king, even though I'm very young and don't know how to rule. Here I am amongst the people, though I'm very young, here I am amongst the people you have chosen to be your own, a people who are so many that they cannot be counted. So give me the wisdom I need to rule your people with justice and to know the difference between good and evil. Otherwise, how would I ever be able to rule this place, this great people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this, and so he said to him, "Because you have asked for the wisdom to rule justly instead of long life for yourself or riches or the death of your enemies, I will do what you have asked. I will give you more wisdom and understanding than anyone has ever had before or will ever have again. I will also give you what you have not asked for. All of your life you will have wealth and honor, more than that of any other king. And if you obey me and keep my laws and commands, as your father David did, I will give you a long life." And our second reading is from the book of John, chapter 6, verses 51 to 58, once again from the Good News Translation. Jesus said, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If you eat this bread, you will live forever. The bread that I will give you is my flesh, which I give you so that the world may live." Well, this started an angry argument among them. "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "I'm telling you the truth. If you do not eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you will not have life in yourselves. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them to life on the last day. For my flesh is the real food. My blood is the real drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood live in me and I live in them. The living Father sent me, and because of him, I live also. In the same way, whoever eats me will live because of me. This then is the bread that came down from heaven. It's not like the bread that your ancestors ate, but then later died. Those who eat this bread will live forever." This is the word of the Lord.
Let's sing again. Have faith in God. The times, they are a-changin', and they are a-challengin'. The pandemic, of course, has continued to dominate our public discussions of late, but last week a second major issue calling for wisdom in our day regained some prominence. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change released a report warning that the timeline that we have to avert the worst effects of climate change is getting tighter. So I asked Lynn Cowan, as one member of our social justice team, if she might offer us a brief reflection on this in relation to our Old Testament reading about wisdom and leadership and God. And I'm grateful to her for coming up with this. I'll hand over to you, Lynn.
The problem with our lectionary system of readings is that we get individual stories, but we seldom get an overview of what is happening. The events described in Judges 1 and 2, Samuel 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings, occurred in the 12th and 11th centuries BC. Now, the Philistines arrived in the area about this time, and they knew the secrets of making tools and weapons out of iron, which the Israelites did not, and that gave the Philistines a great advantage. So these stories of skirmishes and battles, which are told in these books, cover the time of transition in that Middle East area from the Bronze Age to the Iron Age. And it also forced another transition. So instead of being a loose confederation of 12 tribes, Israel had became quite a large, important nation under the leadership of David and then Solomon. So the loyalty of the people had to change from loyalty just to their own small tribe to loyalty to the nation of Israel. And if you read the report from the IPCC, we are in a similar situation today. We are in a period of transition from what will probably be called the period of hydrocarbons, that is coal, oil and natural gas, to the period of renewable energy. And we don't have a lot of time to do it. So maybe God sent us the coronavirus to get us battle ready. As with COVID, so with climate change. We have to adapt to a new reality. We have to change from thinking of ourselves as citizens of Victoria or Australia even, to see ourselves as citizens of the planet as we try to repair the damage to our atmosphere. And we are going to need some very wise, courageous and honest leadership to take us on that journey. And we need a community willing to travel with them. Thank you.
Thanks, Lynn. Very thoughtful and on the money. Because we are in a period of transition. The times are a-changing and a-challenging. We're still early in the age of renewable energy, as Lynn points out, and early in the age of pandemic coronavirus. I suspect that however much the virus might hopefully slip into the background over the next few years, it will have lasting effects on people of all cultures and places. Not just the virus, but how we handle it and how we do things like vaccination passports and so on. And climate change, even more so. How can we survive the challenges of this transition time, make the changes that are needed, and live in hope of thriving again, with hope for ourselves and for our descendants? Well, you may not be surprised when I confess that I don't have all the definitive detailed answers, but I do agree with Lynn's thoughts about leadership and global citizenship understanding. And I think also that we can continue to get some encouragement and focus for ourselves and what we contribute from the story of our ancestors in the faith. So let's have a look at today's Old Testament reading and see how it speaks to us. The reading today opens with the death of King David. David had just finished giving last instructions to Solomon. Remain faithful to the Lord and the covenant between the Lord and David's house. Good stuff. Disconcertingly for us, though, David also told Solomon to eliminate a list of people who did wrong by him and were threats to Solomon's rule. Even on his deathbed, David was a complex mix of faithful servant and ruthless avenger. And Solomon proves to be similar, a complex alignment of ruthlessness and faithfulness. Well, today's reading actually skips over the violence to Solomon's dream at the start of his reign. And we're told quite firmly that Solomon loved the Lord. And as the story goes, that faithfulness dominates the account of his reign through to 1 Kings 10. Though in this dream, we do hear two little warning bells. Solomon sacrificed and offered incense at the high places, which were historically connected with the worship of Baal and other Canaanite deities. And he also made an alliance with Pharaoh of Egypt, which involved marriage to Pharaoh's daughter. There are hints there that all will not be right with Solomon's reign in the long run, and how he might lose his focus and his faithfulness might wane. At first, though, following this dream, it goes brilliantly. In his dream, Solomon is given a choice of anything he wants from the Lord. Solomon's reply is admirable and seen by some as a model for prayerful response to God. He begins by noting the Lord's faithfulness to David and the covenant with David. He praises God. Then he humbly confesses his childlike lack of experience for the burden of kingship. And then he asks for wisdom to govern the people with understanding and justice. And so the Lord is pleased with Solomon's response, since he'd asked for wisdom to rule rather than wealth and life for himself and to deal with his enemies. So the Lord grants his request and also promises the wealth and honor that Solomon didn't ask for. And there's even the promise the Lord will lengthen Solomon's life. So, with this dream and this response of Solomon to God and this request of Solomon to God, the scene is set for the spectacular reign of Solomon. Not only will he maintain the unity of the 12 tribes of Israel under the threat of the Philistines with their advanced weaponry, and the other neighboring countries. But Solomon will also impress all and sundry with his wise judgments and decisions. And those wise judgments and decisions will contribute to translating into stunning wealth and prosperity. However, remember that the Lord's promise to Solomon depended on whether Solomon would walk in my ways, keep my statutes and commandments. God's condition was not so much whether Solomon would continue to observe the religious rituals of the cult, but how he would live as a human being and as a king. And we know how Solomon's father David, despite his giftedness and greatness in many ways, struggled with that very issue. And Solomon continued in that struggle. Solomon's reign would turn out to be a difficult, turbulent time, just like the reign of his father. And Solomon does eventually turn away from the commandments of the Lord. And once again, this would have lasting effects on both those directly involved and those who would follow. And most devastatingly, in the next generation, the kingdom would be split in two. What do we notice for ourselves? As in all the story of the people of God, Israel, the key to Solomon's success or failure was the keeping or breaking of the covenant with God. In the same way that God chose and elevated David, God elevated and equipped Solomon. God initiated a gracious offer and an even more gracious blessing. Ask for whatever you want from me. I will do what you have asked and more if you walk in my ways. So long as you walk in my ways. And throughout the epic Bible narrative, when the times are changing and are challenging especially, God calls deeply flawed and imperfect people to activate God's mission and purposes in the world, to live in covenant relationship. God calls and equips, promises and guides. And when God's people remember to live out their calling in God's ways and to keep turning back to God's ways when they inevitably mess up, then they make a positive difference. The people survive and live with hope that they will thrive again. The New Testament, of course, builds on and develops this framework. In the letter of James in the New Testament, it directs us to ask for wisdom and promises that we will get it. In the first letter to the Corinthians, Paul states that Jesus has become for us wisdom from God. Because as deeply flawed and imperfect people, we do need more than temporary good judgment or ethical insight. We need grace and forgiveness to be freed from the mistakes of the past. And we need love and vision to adapt to changing times, to sense the possibilities for our shared future, and see ourselves as global citizens in God's world, rather than individuals fending for ourselves or our little tribes. The times are a-changing and a-challenging. And so we continue to pray for our leaders of all types, for the wisdom and gifts that they need, for humility with strength and courage with honesty, for vision with compassion. And let's remember to speak of them and treat them with grace as flawed, imperfect people, even as we seek to hold them to account for the responsibilities that they have for all of us, including the poor and the vulnerable. Because our challenge as church is to use our gifts and faith to model and encourage the ways of God. Those ways that prioritise care for the weak and vulnerable, and careful stewardship of the earth, and health and wholeness and peace for all of God's children. Those ways are sustained and empowered by grace, forgiveness, accountability, and self-sacrificial love. Jesus tells us, He is the bread of life that will nourish us in that. And it's so critical what our generation does will leave a powerful legacy. The good news is God is faithful, keeps on hearing our prayers, and keeps on equipping flawed, imperfect people with the gifts that they need for the sake of God's world and God's children. And we are part of that ongoing story. God help us. Thanks be to God.
Join me as we bring our prayers for the people. Loving God, we bring before you our prayers. Lord, we pray in a world of contrasts, this world of beauty and of challenge. We pray for those around us, our families, our neighbours and our community. We rejoice in the securities and comforts that we experience, but we also recognise that amongst us and beyond us are those who are challenged through homelessness, unemployment, addiction and poverty. May we be hands of support and comfort to those we encounter. May we be sharers of your bread of life. We pray for leaders and government here and across the world. May decisions made be decisions of justice and compassion, of care and of truth. We give thanks for stable government. We give thanks for leadership in this country of privilege. Let your light of hope reach into our places and across this land. May your people in parts of the world experiencing hardship at the hands of violent and corrupt government find freedom and peace. We pray for decision makers and leaders in the lives of Aboriginal people in this land. May compassion and equality be part of the dialogue for all Australians. We pray for sustenance in the lives of those living in poverty. We pray for belonging and peaceful arrival in the lives of refugees. Let your light of justice reach all people. Lord, we give thanks for the gifts of your people, for medical science that steers our world through challenge currently, and those who offer their skills to bring about healing. Guide their work and guide the work of all who give that others may receive. We pray for those who struggle to access healthcare and basic needs for living. May you, bread of life, work through your people to bring about equality of services, equality of opportunity, and equality of the things that sustain. Lord, we pray for our environment, the gift of the earth where we live, a garden which your people are called to tend. May decisions at all levels, global, national, and local, be decisions of care for this garden gift. May we decide now for those still to come. Bread of life, guide us in care as we tend this, your earthly garden. Holy Lord, bread of life, we give thanks for your gifts and we pray for peace in our places. We pray for hope in our populations and we pray for love amongst your people. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, the bread of life. Amen.
We are marching in the light of God. Let's sing. Go nourished by the bread of heaven and take care to walk in the ways of wisdom. Discern carefully between right and wrong. Understand what the will of the Lord is. Feed on Christ and be filled with the Spirit. And may God give you a wise and discerning mind. May Christ Jesus fill you with life in all its fullness. And may the Holy Spirit overflow in you in songs of joy and praise forever. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Now go in peace. You are forgiven and set free. Now go in peace to live your life out joyfully. May the hand of God uphold you when your strength is getting low. May the light of Christ shine for you. May the Spirit soothe your soul. Now go in peace. You are forgiven and set free. Now go in peace to live your life out generously. Now go in peace.